thank you very much. So if you can't really hear me well, just raise your hand. Hi, I'm Robert Jan. I am a lead of the R&D department at Sidegroup. As he said, we do deep learning. Mainly we do deep computer vision, so it's even more specific. After the last talk, we've all had a bit of a break to settle down and come a bit more back to earth, which is useful because I'm going to stay a bit more down to earth. I'm actually going to try and explain something about this deep computer vision. But for that, it's kind of practical for me to know what kind of audience I'm dealing with. So I'd like to do some show of hands. Show of hands for who has experience or works in machine learning. All right. So that's maybe half of the people. Deep learning? Okay. Any experience with CNNs, ConvNets? All right. That's a good mix. That's kind of what I was told to expect, so that's nice. I've tailored my slides to this. I will actually try and make all of you understand the concepts behind deep computer vision, behind these basic building blocks, ConvNets. I'm going to try and rely more on intuitions. So I'm going to try and work with some simple diagrams and some intuition so all of you can take something home. You'll see later in the slides in the presentation, I'll have a way of providing some more information for those in the know, but we'll get there. So I work at Sidecorp. Sidecorp is an AI spin-off from the University of Amsterdam. We like to think of ourselves as a computer vision company, but we specialize in face analysis technology. So what does that mean, face analysis technology? It's one of the products that we sell. We actually sell it quite globally, so 5 continents, 25 countries. I'm in the R&D department, first of all, before I get into face analysis. I'm lead of the team. We have a modest team. We're not a very big company. We're spin-off, right? And we concern ourselves mostly with state-of-the-art computer vision, so deep computer vision. Any computer vision that we do with ConvNets, anything a little bit more sophisticated than your traditional older stuff. And we have basically three responsibilities. First of all, we try to improve the products that Sidecorp offers. We have a number of products, and most of them have these deep computer vision backbone technologies. So that's what we work on. Another thing that we do is sometimes we have clients that come that have more specific requests, or they have some specific data they want us to work with that doesn't fit our products exactly, so we'll do some tailor-made solutions, like consultancy, basically. If we have time, we like to experiment with new technologies, anything that we might have noticed from a conference, or maybe one of our salespeople talk to a client that has an interesting problem, and we try and see if we can crack that. Today, I will talk about the first part, improving products, because we're going to be talking about face analysis. So this is what you see when you get on our website. We do computer vision and deep learning for real-time face analysis. So that last part is important, real-time face analysis. And that's actually what I'm going to talk to you about today. So we're doing face analysis in real time, which means that it needs to be efficient, right? There's a lot of different ways to do ConvNets, and we've seen with the other, with your presentation, Daniel, for example, it's really easy with deep neural nets to make them really slow but really accurate. That doesn't really work for our customers because they want to process real-time video streams. So we need to be efficient. And I'll give you some intuitions behind for what's behind all of this today. So what do I mean by face analysis? This is the main product that we sell. We sell it in a couple of different ways. There's an SDK, there's an API. Basically, it's all the same backbone text. And we can offer something where we take an image, and then for each image, we can tell you, or for a video stream, we can tell you for all the faces in that stream or in that image, the gender, the age, facial expressions of the people, also the pose. So are they like looking, which way are they looking? Are they looking at some target? And there's another thing we do, which is face landmarks, which is something that developers can use. It's where you basically identify each different part of the face. So that's something, for example, you can use to do facial expressions. Well, we have that one already, but it's something for developers. So let me go through some applications of face analysis before we get to the good stuff. One popular application is something we call anonymous audience analytics. Say you have a store, right? You run a store, you and your wife and your daughter, you all work shifts in the store. You get a good sense of what people come into your store, right? Because you see most of them, or you know the people that work in the store, so you talk to them, you get some good anecdotal evidence. Say you're actually H&M, right? Or you're some big retailer, you have hundreds or maybe thousands of people nationwide working in your stores. You have no idea what kind of people actually come into the stores. right? You can talk to all of your people, but they don't want to do that, right? So what you can do with our software is if you actually put up a camera right at the entrance, you can have some analytics for the people that come into your store. With our software, we can give you the gender, the age, we can tell you if they were happy or not, if they were surprised, or maybe, let's hope, not disgusted. And this can really help you to know what you're, if you're reaching your target demographic or not. It's all anonymous, right? We don't store identities of people. It's really about just the analytics. Another example, say you're an ad company and you have these new modern screens on the streets with advertisements, right? You can change those on the fly if you want, right? You can swap them out. Usually I think now they just swap them out every 10, 20 seconds. But how do you know as an ad company the kind of people that you're reaching, right? You're just putting out an ad right there, and you might talk with the people that run the place or run the train station or whatever and talk about what kind of demographics they have, but you don't know for sure. So one thing you can do with our software is you can actually have adaptive advertisements. So you have a camera, you have this stream, you find the anonymous faces, and we know, okay, this is a female, and she's probably 25 years old. So we can actually show her, for example, this L'Oreal ad, right? But maybe she walks away, and then somebody else comes by, and we see, okay, this is a guy, he's probably 34 years old. We might want to show him this advertisement. So this is very useful, right? It's not just useful for the ad company, it's useful for the company that is pushing the ad because they can better reach their target demographic. And honestly, I mean, I like it better to see ads that I care about than see ads that I don't care about. You know, every time that I turn on the TV these days and you have to sit through one of those 7-minute ad blocks and I'm looking at, you know, laundry detergent or something, and I'm not used to this anymore, you know, with all the stuff that I see, you know, all the videos you see online, you have your specialized ads. We can do that actually in real life with this software. Another thing, you can count people, right? Might be very useful if you're NS or if you're Schiphol and you want to know what kind of flow of people you have. You don't even need to have the age and gender stuff for that, but you can do it all the same with the software. And another thing, let's go back to the store example. Maybe you want to know what kind of impact you're having on people's lives, right? So somebody walks into the store, you can measure the average mood of people walking into the store, and you can also measure it when they're working out, right? You do cameras opposite to each other. And you can do this with different places in the same store. There's a whole lot of applications. This is just scratching the surface, really. So what does it look like? So this is actually basically a screen grab from the website. We have a demo of the API. So on the right is some JSON snippet that shows you just the kind of data that comes out. And on the left is our volunteer, the CTO of the company, Roberto Valenti, who is his face appears in many demo images. At the company, he's a brave soul, and it says he's 31 years old, he's male, he's mostly happy at this point, he's wearing black clothes, as he usually is, so this white thing is supposed to point in the direction where he's looking, right? So that's the pose. So we have this face analysis. We do gender, we do age, facial expressions, pose, face landmarking, all these technologies. So we go from this image to these technologies, but how do we get there? You know, for a human, it's pretty simple, right? We look at this picture of this guy, and you know, we can say something about him. He's a guy, right? Most likely, I don't know how old he is. That's pretty easy for humans. For machines, it's more complicated. Most of you are probably aware that a machine doesn't really see a person there. It just sees a spatial arrangement of pixels, right? Of red, green, and blue values. So we need something in between this. We need something to get from A to B, and we need actually face detection. Face detection is the task of taking an image and basically saying there's a face here, there's a face there, there's a face there, right? We're trying to locate these, and we can draw nice little squares around them, which we call bounding boxes. And that's the task of face detection. It's really important for our face analysis product, and that's what I'll talk about today. So I'll give you a bit of a warning. This comes back to what I said earlier. I'm gonna stay pretty high level. For those that are interested, in the blue boxes you'll find some more specifics. Also, don't be afraid to come up after me, ask questions after this, or come up to me at the drinks and ask about some specifics. I'll just if you see me explaining anything in the blue box, then and you didn't raise your hand earlier, then just ignore that. So the problem is face detection. This is actually something that is you know, been solved quite a long time ago, especially for the picture on the left. It's a big picture, it's a pretty big face, it's easy to find. And it looks like we would expect the face to look like. Well, okay, it's maybe not the best example, but you know, it's a pretty standard human. On the right, actually, we have a more complicated image. There's a lot of people there. Most of them are looking towards the camera, but some aren't, you know. Some are screaming the other way, and some are screaming into their phone. And, you know, some are not even visible because there might be hands or arms in the way. So that's a lot more complicated, and that's actually not very trivial to do. First of all, the simple approach, right? The traditional approach, there's an algorithm called Viola-Jones. It's pretty old by now, and it's really just based around this idea of contrasting regions. This thing is called a hair feature, and there's a whole collection of those, and the algorithm basically works by applying each of those to the image, and then you have some judgment based on that, and you know whether you have a face or not. Why does this work? Because these hair features are basically arrangement of, you know, dark brightness and light brightness. And for example, this one might actually match a nose, right? If you think about what does a nose look like in black and white, it's probably more white in the middle and more black to the sides, right? So that's why this one works for nose. And there's these for, you know, for eyes, for all the other parts of faces. And if they're in a certain arrangement, you can say, okay, I've got a face. The problem with that, though, is that it makes a lot of assumptions on what a face looks like, right? It assumes that you have your nose in the middle, and it's not upside down, it's like the right way up. So this starts to break down quite fast if we get images like these. You know, this is an even bigger crowd, and people are basically all looking towards the left, so that's not going to match all of our hair features. Viola-Jones won't really work there. This guy is even, well, I mean, you know, you can barely even see a nose or something, but there's still a face there, so we would still want to find it, right? It's a pretty extreme example, but it's on one end of the spectrum, and somewhere in this spectrum, you know, it's going to be arbitrary to say, let's stop here. So we really just want to find all these people. So let's talk about ConvNets, or CNNs, it's all the same, really, convolutional neural networks. So this is where I'm going to, you know, stay a little bit high level and explain to you more the intuitions. So we have our same guy up here, right? We have our same image. So what convolutional neural nets do, they're models, they're algorithms that take as input an image. So it's just, you know, width by height by a certain amount of colors. And that's the input, and the output is going to be one number, right? And the way we get there is because ConvNets are actually combinations of layers. So ConvNets these days can have up to 50 or 100 layers. For simplicity's sake, we'll say they have 4. And each of these transitions is a layer, right? So what does a ConvNet do? It learns a lot of different functions. And each of these functions is actually a pretty small function. So you see here, it's pretty small, but here you see a 3x3, let's assume these are pixels, right? 3x3 pixels, so 9 pixels. And we're going to learn a function that takes these and compresses them into just one number in the next layer. And we're going to apply that function over the entire image. So we get a whole lot of numbers, right? It's still spatially arranged. It still kind of looks like an image, but it's not exactly an image. And each layer does this. So each layer has these functions that compresses and compresses and compresses until we get one final number. Now, there's a whole lot to, you know, why this works, how you can learn these. There's also a whole lot of material on the internet that can explain you why. I'm not going to go into it because that would be the rest of the talk. And then you don't know anything about face detection yet. So for now, we'll assume that this works, right? We can learn these. What happens? What does this ConvNet actually do? It does two major things. First, because we're learning these small functions, each time that we add a function to it, it gets more and more complex. Every time that we add a layer, we get a more complex combination of what came before. So in the beginning, we have just pixels, just values for red, green, and blue. If we go a couple layers deep, so let's say the first layer, we actually get something that looks like this. So we can see that the network has learned to pick up what we call edges, which is just, it looks kind of similar to the hair features we saw before from Viola-Jones, just differences in brightness, right? It learns to see this is like a dark patch is next to a bright patch. But in all kinds of different orientations and different shapes, and there's a whole whole set of them, right? There's a lot of different features there. We go deeper to the second layer in this case, we start to see that we can combine all of this into more semantically meaningful things. So but we start to see some eyes, right? We start to see some mouths, maybe some noses somewhere. We're starting to see parts of faces. And then the magical next step, basically, we can combine these again into even more complex things. So we start to see actual faces, but they are faces with slight variations. So there's a guy with a mustache there, and there's people, you know, they're kind of translated over the image, they're kind of like shifted. And in the end, if we then do one more layer from here to just a single number, we can predict, is there a face or not? So that's the one. That's one thing that Confinets do, that CNNs do, is they build up complexity over time so that in the beginning you have a whole lot of numbers that don't mean anything. At the end, you have one number that means everything, basically. The other thing that is important for this talk that you know is CNNs build, so they build this complexity, but they also compress. So we have a lot of numbers. This is the same network as before, but we go down to just one number, right? We collapse all of this information into this single number, and it's still, layer by layer, it's still capturing the entire image, right? This part now ends up here. This rough part starts ending up here. So even in the end, this number still represents the entire image. So if you actually show that on the image, it looks like this. So in the beginning, we have these numbers that represents very small patches, and these patches become bigger and bigger until we match the entire image. So that's the two things. We learn complex information that ends up in the final layer, and in the final layer, we also have a very compact representation. Now, why is this important, right? It turns out that you can do a lot of useful things at the end of these ConvNets, right? A lot of applications are classification, for example. Let's say we want to know if this guy, for example, has a mustache or not. We can learn a network that will tell us, okay, 90% sure he's a mustache, or 10% sure he has a mustache. But we can also do face or not. We can say, okay, 90% sure there's a face in this image or not. Right, as I said, so here's some detail. For this compactness, we actually call like a receptive field. The final layer has a bigger receptive field than the initial layers. So let's say we want to do face detection with this network. We will do our entire network. I just rearranged it a little bit for, you know, for so I can fit the other stuff on the slide. And at the end, we have this one number, and we can say, okay, this number represents if there's a face or not. So let's say we have one detection here, right? We draw a bounding box over this image, and we say, okay, we found a face somewhere in here. That's not very useful, because, I mean, it's just telling me if there's a face in the image or not. I want to know where it is, right? This box is way too big, because this final neuron is just modeling just the entire image. So that's a problem, right? So if we actually want to detect a face, we want to know where it is. How do we do this? Well, there is one network, and I'm, you know, kind of disappointed by the name of it. It's called YOLO. Yeah, deep learning researchers have this annoying habit of thinking they're funny when they're naming their important architectures after memes. This architecture is actually called YOLO. It stands for you only learn once. There's another one that's called Look, thank you very much. Very sure. There's actually another one that's called Inception, and that's named after the movie because they started adding more layers and they figured we need to go deeper. Anyway, so YOLO basically is the simplest way to do detection with a ConvNet. Basically, you just stop earlier. You don't go into these deeper layers. You just stop here. And then you say, okay, each of these numbers can represent whether there's a face or not. And now you can get these kind of bounding boxes, right? So it's still not ideal for this picture, but at least we can start to find faces of these sizes. So the details here is that it's actually from this representation, you're doing one more 3x3 convolution, and you predict the amount of classes, and for each patch, you also predict twice coordinates and confidences. Right? This is all on the paper, and I can't really go in depth, but just putting it there for those that are interested. So that's nice, right? Now we at least can find multiple faces in the image, but at least we're still pretty tied to how big they can be, right? They need to be exactly that big. This means we're not going to really find this guy, right? Because we might, you know, paint it on his nose, but that's not what we want. So we need a network that can handle multiple skills, a multi-skill network. Because we want to find him, but we also want to find all of these people. So this is our network. With the simple solution we tried, we wanted to use this one. With YOLO, we're using this one. Well, there's another network called SSD. And SSD basically does a very simple trick. It says, well, I don't want to use this one or this one. I want to use all three of these. That's called the single-shot multi-box detector. So basically, we can. There's no reason we couldn't do this. We just need to make sure the network continues doing its whole thing, and then we can use this one to get the blue bounding boxes we saw before. We can this one to use to get the green bounding boxes, and we can use this one, the intermediate one, to get the orange bounding boxes. And this one actually matches what we want. This one actually gives us the face we want, right? So you can extend this to how many layers you want, and you can get more fine-grained differences in scale. But now we have a face detector. It's simplified, but now we have a face detector. And we actually only care really about that, you know, that center face. That's the one that we're going to learn on. So when we then, you know, go into the specifics, the loss function, we only really care about that detection. And for SSD specifically, it's slightly different than the other ones. So 3x3 convolution, and you, for every class, you predict coordinates and confidences. So this is what this is the image from the paper, the SSD paper. The Hulk Hogan images are courtesy of my colleague. And they nicely show how you can have multiple sizes faces in there. I love that image. This is your standard ConvNet. This is actually with a VGG-based network. And they added some more layers that keep going down and down in size. And you can attach these prediction layers early and in the middle and towards the end. And then you get your different sizes. Key things to take away there. You need to be careful how you arrange your layers, right? And you need to be careful of what kind of face size you can actually find with this. So the standard SSDs take 6 layers, as you can see. I think 5 of them are six of them are displayed here. Each of these peaks represents one of the face sizes that we actually matched to with this architecture. But in between, we're still going to do relatively poor because these faces don't exactly they fall right in between two layers. And the other thing is that so this might be for the later layer, you actually get a pretty big bounding box. And this is for the earlier one. So that kind of shows how you need to do this matching, right? There's another thing there that for early layers, you get a really big number of negatives, a really big amount of patches where you don't predict the face. And that becomes tricky when you optimize these networks. So that's SSD. That's a basic model. That's from 2016, I believe. And it's a very popular basic architecture. So then there's been a lot of refinements. So this slide is an example of a paper that kind of refines it a year later. And this is another related idea. I don't know exactly how much time I have, but I think that counts down, right? Okay, so then I should wrap up. So if you're interested, feature pyramid networks basically deal with the concept that the early layer of the SSD don't have a lot of complexity. As we saw before, right, we're building this with more layers. So the early layers are not very complex. But if you actually go back afterwards and you combine those layers, you do a top-down, so a pyramid, what they're calling it, you can have the best of both worlds. So read into that if you want. There's other methods to wrap up for face detection. We have only considered really efficient ones. There are other networks that are less efficient but more accurate. So these are the most popular ones, the RCNN branch of models and the RFCN, somewhat more recent. If you actually look at the leaderboards, this is an object detection baseline that is used in a lot of conferences, for those who know the COCO leaderboards. These are the top 10, and you see that these heavier methods are towards the top, but FPN is also there, right? So you can get a lot, you can get far with the concept of FPN. So let me conclude. Face analysis, I showed you, really useful, right? We need face detection to do it, though. And that can be tricky. You really need to be careful about what is going to be your deployment environment, right? Is it going to be on device, like with a lot of customers we have, or is it going to be in the cloud, and you can use a much heavier model? And still then, for each method, there's going to be things that are tricky about it that you need to optimize. So it's a very challenging problem, but I like those, so I like to work on this. And in the end, you get something really worthwhile that a lot of people like to use. So in conclusion, if you liked all of this, and you're like, wow, I want to work on that as well, we're actually hiring. people of all levels of experience we're looking for. Working at the Science Park Amsterdam, right by the UvA. If you're interested in this, come up to me or go to the websites there. That's all pretty obvious. All right. References right here. There's a link to the slides if you want to get them. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert-Jan. Any questions?
So at the beginning, you mentioned the example of the adaptive ad board, let's say, and these type of things. How does one, let's say, monitor the performance of, because I mean, let's say one is live, let's say the model decides to choose a certain ad. How does one monitor the performance, you know, or do you just, or is that the assumption that once the model is trained, it's going to perform similarly over time?
Yeah, so we are a pretty small company. We try to focus only on the tech. So we have ways to evaluate, you know, are all of these analysis components working right? But mostly we sell to companies that, you know, that are the ad providers or are maybe even a party in between that can, you know, group all of this up and sell it as a more whole package. So we generally don't really even have to concern ourselves with that. Mm-hmm. We just try to get to the companies that are the ad companies or maybe even in between.
Anyone else?
Yeah, thank you for your nice presentation. What are the current challenges in this face detection models, and how could they be improved?
The smaller you go in terms of faces, the harder it becomes to do anything useful, especially if they need to be somewhat efficient. So if you have a big model, you can get pretty small. You know, even maybe 5x5 pixels can be doable. You get to a level where humans have trouble distinguishing faces, right? Because, you know, can you distinguish a face between from a hand at that big a distance or that smaller resolution mostly? But that is, you know, that's what's nice about this field. Some things might be more trivial when you have more compute, but it's even more challenging if you have to do it with very little compute, right? So that's one of the things. This is only about face detection, right? It belongs to this bigger class of tasks called object detection, where you have multiple classes. You can do there's class imbalance to deal with sometimes. That's mostly it. Yeah.
I wonder. So I understand from your presentation how you can count the number of people on a picture. But if I have a store and I want to see how many people are going in and out, how do you do that? Because you can at any time see how many people are inside. But how do you know whether they are the same people or other people that have gone in and out?
Yeah, that's a good question. So if you do image by image, right, it's simple to evaluate. But if you have a video stream, you don't want to count the same person twice on the next frame because you get really inflated numbers. So there are some basic tracking for that. That can just be... That's generally simpler stuff. I don't really do that kind of stuff. But so that's actually stuff that's been in the company for a long time. And that's just built into the backbone that'll take all these individual images and then match all these faces to each other. But yeah, that's definitely something that we need to think about. You know, personally, I'd like to also investigate if we can, you know, integrate it into these models to give them a temporal dimension. But that is definitely more experimental.
So now you are actually classifying whether two faces on two pictures are the same or not?
Roughly, yes, roughly. It's these kind of algorithms are not even necessarily made for faces, but more for shapes. And it's just a very small window, so we can compare between a couple of frames and keep track of what it roughly looks like, and then we forget about it, right? So we don't store any identity information. It's not like the thing doesn't build a database of faces or something. That's explicitly what it's not supposed to do. But you still got to track between frames.
Are you guys also incorporate heat signatures, like infrared images?
So I think there's definitely parties in the business that do that. We try to, you know, aim more for the lower segment. You know, if you run a store, it's cheaper to get a webcam than it is to get a heat sensor. So that's why we try to focus mostly on people that can just set it up with a small machine with a simple CPU inside and like a Logitech webcam or something. So that's definitely a segment of the market, but we don't focus on that.
Okay, then that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.